Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me? Can you hear my voice clearly? Okay, yeah, then it's time to welcome you to IEEE PES webinar series 2020. Today we have the topic optimize efficiency in substation equipment condition assessment. So the speaker is Mr. Christian Eng. So he received his degree from the Higher Technical College for Electronics and Telecommunications in 1998 in Innsbruck, Austria. Then he started to work with Omicron in 2001 as application support engineer at Omicron Electronics headquarters in Krauss, Austria. Then in 2009, he joined Omicron Electronics Asia in Hong Kong and presently hold the position as area sales manager and regional training manager. During his time at Omicron, he gained knowledge and experience in the field of secondary testing, as well as diagnostic and online monitoring of primary power equipment. So my name is Thanapong Suanasi. I'm a lecturer at the Sirinton International Thai German Graduate School of Engineering, Khieu Mongkut University of Technology, North Bangkok. So for this webinar, optimize efficiency in substation equipment condition assessment, as you've seen in the brochure, this is quite an interesting topic because we have a limit of time for testing, but we need to gain more information as much as possible to assess the condition of the equipment. And that's why the combination of different test methods in one test equipment is so important, that the speaker will share his knowledge and experience in this field for us today. So we have 1 hour's time from 2:30 to 3:30. Then during the presentation, you can leave your questions in the chat. Then after finish the presentation, then the speaker could read your question from the chat and answer the question question by question that can speed up the time. Okay, then now it's time to hand over the screen to the speaker. Please welcome Mr. Christian Eng.
Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, Dr. Thanapong. Can you hear me?
Yes, clearly.
Yeah. So first of all, allow me to say thank you for the opportunity to speak here at the webinar of the webinar series that you are holding together with IEEE Thailand. Mm-hmm. I would like to say thank you also to Unipower for their invitation to join this. And yeah, so let me begin with my presentation. First of all, I have asked for a little help from my colleague Kushbu Thakur, who is our regional application specialist. She is with Omicron now since I think 5 or 6 years, whereas she is since 2 years with us in Hong Kong, and she has a very good knowledge in the field of primary testing. So if you have questions, maybe at the end, if it's too many questions for one of us to answer, we will work together on this. Okay, so before I begin with the topic, just very quick about our company, Omicron. We have now worldwide more than 900 team members from 45 countries, located in 25 offices and serving customers in more than 160 countries worldwide. Our focus is on developing reliable testing solutions. They're also innovative. And most of our production is happening in Austria and also Germany to some part. And we look at it as our mission, so to say, together with our many partners in the world, in Thailand specifically, Unipower Engineering, to create a sort of win-win situation with our customers, which we try to establish from our side through the products that can last for a very long time, that are very high in efficiency, in usage, and also we try to provide the best support we can. If you want to find more information, you can see the website here, and you can also contact us at any time. Okay, so let me begin with the topic. And first of all, the bigger picture, or so to say, the overall goal that we have is to have a safe and reliable power supply to everybody. And symbolized by this picture here from the city of Hong Kong, where I'm living at the moment. And it's this and the opposite. The worst case scenario would be a blackout or no energy. But not only this, it's also important to consider the safety of the people, and not just the operators, but also the general population. Electricity is a can be a dangerous topic, so it's very important to ensure the safety of everyone involved. Okay, so still with the bigger picture, what are some of the challenges that we have nowadays for the electrical infrastructure? The first one is, or one of the biggest challenges is that we have an increasing power demand. That is because we have increased population density, industrialization, and more need for power. And at the same time, the equipment that is there is getting older day by day. So this basically also means that the risk is increasing day by day. Then we have a change in technology. We have now the need to have also more renewable energy resources, which means that we have isolated power plants that are appearing, and to integrate those is another challenge into the existing grid, as well as other modern technology, for example, the increased use of e-mobility. More people are using electric cars, electric motorbikes that need to be charged. So this also can, you know, lead to an unforeseeable extra stress. And stress is also the overall common factor that we are talking about, because at the end of the day, it means more stress on the insulation of the medium voltage and especially high voltage assets. And this insulation is also what keeps the people safe. So more stress on this insulation is an increased risk. Now, there are some factors that we have influence on and some factors that we do not really have an influence on. Possible risk factors are the extreme weather. There could be storm or just in general an increased temperature or other weather-related factors. Then there could be natural disasters, earthquakes, or even tsunamis could also have an impact on the condition of our equipment. And then there is the electrical failure in the substation, which we are familiar with, and system maloperation if things don't work as they should, or if there is a maloperation of the system protection and of other factors as well. So if we now go closer to the substation, if we look at it from this perspective, what do we want? First of all, we want to have operations without failure, but if failures happen, then at least we want to have our protection work as it is intended. So we want a safe substation, basically. But not just this, we also want the correct substation in that sense that the energy that is going through it is correctly measured, so we can also account for it in the best possible way. And then, of course, the maybe big goal is to have a long lifetime of our equipment as long as possible, and at the same time as safe as possible. And overall, we would reach, like with this little engineer here in the chair, symbolized a sort of relaxing environment. When we go in the substation, we have a feeling of safety and we know that things are working as they should. So now when we look at the electrical network, we see from the generation all the way to the distribution, whether it is the industry or the household customer, there is a chain of elements. And As the saying goes, a chain is only as strong as its weakest link. We can then also say that if only one of these elements has a problem, and even if it's just a small problem first, it can lead to a bigger problem, and which can lead to a very big problem. And that is why it's important to have as good as possible information on the condition of all the elements that are there in the chain. And today, the focus of this would be on the three things: the power transformers, the instrument transformers, and the circuit breakers. Now, let's begin with the power transformers. They are very important elements in the substation, for they are necessary to be able to transport the energy over long distances, but also to contain the energy, because while we are operating them, it must be possible for us to touch them. So while inside there is a lot of energy, outside it must be possible for us to move around safely. And if you look at the power transformer, it is a very complex object that consists of many different parts and also many materials. And because of this, lots of problems can happen. Now we just very quickly look through the elements of the power transformer here. We have the bushings. The bushings are special in that sense that a lot of energy is concentrated on a relatively small space where we bring it out of the winding into the line or cable. And so the insulation here is very important. And the insulation is usually done with a capacitive system with many capacitive layers and an oil insulation and a paper insulation. And there are many things that could impact the quality of this insulation and lead to a partial or complete breakdown with potentially a very bad outcome. So therefore, it is possible to test the integrity of the bushings in regular intervals. Next, there is the insulation material in the core, arguably one of the most important things, as mentioned before. This is what keeps the energy where it needs to be, away from where we are, so to say. And the insulation is made up of different materials. We have paper, we have wood, press board, and then we have also a lot of oil, transformer oil. And here, main risks are that water would enter the transformer over time and contaminates the quality or impacts the quality of the insulation, especially the paper insulation. And also that an aging takes place of the oil, which leads to the breakdown of the quality and the byproducts that you do not want to have there. Next part here would be the leads. The leads, they are basically resembling the connection between the tap changer and the windings. And what can happen here is that bad contacts can get worse and develop hot spots. And also if the transformer is going through a mechanical stress, that can happen through movement or through a short circuit current or through an earthquake, for example. In that case, the leads can be deformed, which can also lead to problems. And next, one culprit that relatively often causes trouble is the on-load tap changer. And this is because it is one of the few moving parts on the transformer that often basically operates to regulate the secondary voltage of the transformer based on the demand of the user. So there are lots of things that can happen on the tap changer because of we are working with contacts, or contact problems can happen, wear and tear of them, and then also open connections and other things can happen on the tap changer. And then the windings themselves, this is where the energy is passing through, and the windings, they can have different kinds of problems. They can have interruptions, they can have short circuits or short circuits between different windings or between the parallel conductors. And last but not least, the transformer core, which is made up of many sheets of metal, usually a very solid element, but even the transformer core can be impacted through mechanical movements of the transformer, either through the short circuit currents or movement, or as I said before, when an earthquake happens. So long story short, we have many different parts and many things that can go wrong, and things also do go wrong sometimes, as we see here in these pictures. And when it happens, it can be very catastrophic and very dangerous for the operators and also the surrounding equipment. One reason why these pictures look so dramatic when transformers literally explode is because of the oil that is contained and that is very inflammable and leads to these kind of pictures. And afterwards, there is often not much to do. It says here post-mortem after that. So it would be good, and we can see the energy that is also exercised here to find these problems in time before that happens. And here are some examples where the defects could be identified in time. For example, this first example is from a breakdown of a low voltage winding, where there was a short circuit between two of these strands, and such a defect could be detected by a winding resistance measurement. And yeah, in this case, still lucky. The second example here, this is the parallel connection lead from the tap changer. Here we can see where the hand points, there is a carbonated area. I'm zooming in a bit, and this has been because of a bad contact that got worse over time, and this could be identified through the winding resistance measurement, as we see here on the third phase. Low voltage winding, we have a higher value than on the two other phases. So zooming in, yeah, so we can see the conductor itself, the copper, the paper has gone, and the copper has already carbonated. And the third example here, we are looking at the on-load tap changer that is deformed. And that also is a reason, because of a high short circuit current, deformation took place and the contacts were moved. And then it was found because there was an arcing happening because of this mechanical deformation. So also lucky in this case, the oil test was the test that found the problem. And then, yeah, this is a closer view on it, and it made a hole in the OLTC compartment, and the oil was mixed, or could go then through the main compartment, and then it was found through the normal oil test. And here we see an example of a problem on a bushing. A power factor test was done. Dissipation factor test was done over frequency, and we see here one bushing has a very different result. At the low frequency, the power factor goes up very much, and that usually is an indicator for some moisture inside the insulation in the paper. And when bushing was then opened, and when opening the bushing, one could see here this black lines here, this is a result of a surface PD, partial discharge, that was because of the water ingress in this bushing. Luckily, there was a spare bushing that could be replaced, and then a more serious problem could be avoided. Yeah, so overall stress on the insulation can have many origins. This is a little bridge to help remember it. T for thermal stress, that the overload through the high load on the transformer or the high temperature. Then the electrical stress, switching surges, lightning or overvoltage. Ambient stress is when moisture gets into the insulation or the acids or aging byproducts or other contamination in the oil. And mechanical stress, either through movement of the transformer itself or through when a short circuit current goes through it. So there are many statistics, but what we see from these statistics is that failures can happen on all the parts of the transformer, and they also do happen on all the parts of the transformer. There are some parts where it is more often than others. Let's say in this statistic, we see that the tap changer relatively often causes a problem, and this is also in other statistics the case, and also in the winding itself, because perhaps because this is also where all the energy is passing through, that these are areas where we have more problems than others. But nevertheless, in the bushings and also in other parts, the connection leads, we find considerable number of trouble and problems. So when we further go then and look at the next element, which would be the instrument transformers, we see that, take a look, we have different kinds of instrument transformers. We have current transformers and voltage transformers, and they are subject to similar similar problems in some part than the power transformers. But here another aspect also comes into play, because the instrument transformers are needed for, first of all, the protection, to ensure the proper protection of the energy system, and also the metering. So for these components of the network, accuracy is a very important factor. So in other words, if they don't work properly, if they're not really accurate, then the protection can be compromised. And when the protection can be is compromised, that can itself lead to quite big problems. Yep. So here we have different pictures of CTs, current transformers. On top, we have the tank. There is the primary connection, which normally just goes through, and the secondary winding around it. Sometimes we have multiple windings for protection and metering purpose. And then the secondary connectors, they are brought down to the terminal box through the insulator. In case of a combined instrument transformer, where we have a current transformer and voltage transformer in one unit, we have the current transformer on the top, like in the previous case, and on the bottom we have another tank where we have a voltage transformer inside with a primary and a secondary winding. Sometimes there is a need for saving space, then these combined units are very very good for this. Looking at types of voltage transformers, basically we distinguish between two: the inductive voltage transformer and the capacitive voltage transformer. And here the deciding factor is mostly the voltage level, because inductive, purely inductive voltage transformers, they get quite big with higher voltage levels, so that instead a capacitive voltage transformer is used, which also has an inductive voltage transformer at the bottom, but a capacitive divider on top of it to bring down the voltage level, so in order to be able to save the material. As with the power transformer, the instrument transformer can also have various problems happening, and in fact often, or relatively often, also cause a lot of trouble and even dangerous trouble. And in this case, there is a CT that exploded because of an open circuit. When an open circuit happens, a dangerous voltage can appear, or even when there is a short circuit, as in the second picture. And then VT started burning here because of a ferroresonance and increasing dangerously increasing current. This picture here at the bottom is the same incident, but afterwards, also it's like basically totally destroyed, and also a VT with a short circuit on the secondary side. So many problems can happen. And in a similar fashion as with the power transformer, we see again that, yeah, it is not really one part that is more often, or yeah, we can say some parts are more often the cause than others, but we have a very diverse pattern again, and trouble can happen in relatively many places of the instrument transformer. Yeah, here that another aspect that comes into play with the instrument transformer, as I said before, it's not only about keeping it safe, but it's also about keeping it accurate. Because if there is an instrument transformer, let's say a VT and a CT, and both are only 0.1% out of the specification, it can lead to actually relatively large loss of revenue in a year, or maybe you are overcharging a customer, which maybe also is not a very nice thing. But yeah, just to point out that it is, this factor also is quite important with regards to the instrument transformers. Next object that we are looking at will be the circuit breaker. Now, the circuit breakers are very important because they switch our grid on and off, and they need to do so safely and whenever it needs to happen, especially in case of a fault, so when the protection relay will tell them to operate. And there are many different types of circuit breakers, but in a way, they all function similarly. There is the interrupter, in which we are opening, which we are basically separating the energy, and they need to operate under load, under high voltage. Then we have the support insulator, which also includes the mechanical linkage between the bottom part where there is the operating mechanism and the control of the circuit breaker. So all these elements need to function well together, because it is very important that the circuit breaker operates very fast. And here, if we look at the wear and tear process and what can happen, there is basically two distinguishing factors. One is that what happens, or how it is affected in the stationary closed position. This is basically when energy is going through the circuit breaker, which is mostly the case. So different consequences can be that because of the climatic influence, the insulation gets deteriorated, or that it gets polluted, and then it can lead to a flashover, and that contact temperature rises, the wear of contacts. This is also a self-accelerating process. If the contacts wear down and the resistance increases, the temperature rises further, and so on. And also very critical, a jammed operating mechanism. So especially when a circuit breaker doesn't operate for a very long time, it can become slow. Slow in that sense that for us, if we look at it, it will still be fast, but from the electrical perspective, or for how fast it should be, that it would already cause a problem. And then there is another aspect, the wear and tear process during the switching, because we have the high energy there, and it can also deteriorate the contact and also wear down the mechanical parts, because of there is a lot of energy moving in a circuit breaker under pressure. And here again, if you look at the failure statistic, problem can happen in all of the elements. So in summary, looking at the substation, lots of trouble can happen and also will happen. And therefore, it's important, just like for us as people, to find the problem before it becomes too bad. And this is basically shown in this graphic. So we have on the graphic on the right, you see the beginning of the life of the asset. And with time, the condition will get worse until we reach the expected service life of that asset. And there we have the negative influences that will bring this curve to the left. And with testing and corrective measures, we can find the trouble and we can fix it and we can extend the lifetime. So this sounds very easy, but in fact it is not, because as we have seen, problems can happen in many areas of each of the assets in question. So we would need to do a lot of testing to find them, and that is a time-consuming aspect. So a summary here in the middle of my presentation, we have many different failures that can happen. So it's important to detect problems early, to avoid the breakdown and to avoid the harm of the operator. Then a good way to do it is comprehensive testing, but comprehensive testing takes a long time and also requires long outages. Now, if we look at it in terms of how much time, from our experience, traditional ways of conventional testing that include range of tests as they are written down here, I'm not going to go into detail, but this is basically what is done for a transformer, instrument transformer, to verify the accuracy, and also the circuit breakers, timing, the resistance measurement, coil motor current, and so on. So with traditional conventional test methods, we would reach test times of around a whole working day, some 8 hours on one power transformer, maybe a half a day on an instrument transformer and a similar time on a circuit breaker. Now these times are very long. So the question is, how is it possible to reduce the outage time for testing, but without compromising on results and especially safety? So what we are looking at basically is efficiency. So we have to ensure safety. We would like to improve the testing time, but we do not want to get less results. We would like to get as many results as possible. And when we look at this, so with safety and with a low effort, physical and mental effort. In a short testing time, we want to get comprehensive results. We have to fulfill all these criteria in order to achieve this efficiency. And earlier today, in another presentation, I have stolen this slide from my good friend, Alex Apostolov. Maybe you know him. So he also likes to talk about efficiency, and I would like just to talk about the fourth point here, minimize the impact of the testing on the availability of the power system components and protection. Because we are interrupting the grid during testing, and we are also interrupting in a way the protection. So the sooner we can finish, the better it is. So now, when we think about how we can optimize the process, it's good to take a look first how the process looks like. So if we enter in a substation, or even before we enter in the substation, we will prepare the testing. This mostly happens in the office. Let's say we are making a plan for which kind of tests we are doing. We are thinking about how long they would take, how much time is available. So this is the preparation time. Then we arrive at the substation, then we have to isolate the test equip device under test and make it safe, ground it, so we can go there and do our testing. Then we would do the connection of our test set to that asset. And then we would carry out the first test. And this is the yellow is always a test on one phase, and then we do the red. The red little bar here is resembling the reconnection to phase two and then phase three. And then we would do a rewiring to a second test. Let's say this is a transformer, we would do a winding resistance test or a ratio test, and then we would do the rewiring, and then we would do the next test. And so on, for a comprehensive measurement that will show us many potential problems or give us the safety, the peace of mind, we would need to do a few tests. So let's say we do four tests. And after we have finished four tests, we would need to remove the wiring from our test set, and we would reconnect it to the grid. And we would then take all our results, process them, make a report, and so on. So if this is the conventional approach, and the question is, how can we improve this? Then it's about removing effort and removing time. So first, it's about the reduction of the physical effort. You see, there is a lot of connection going on between the phases and between the tests. So if we can remove this need for reconnection, then we already have saved a lot. That would be basically this crossing out and this crossing out. But then that's not everything. We are talking about the physical work, but there is also the mental work, so to say, the thing that we have to do before in the preparation phase and also during the testing. So if these times that we have there, we can reduce them to shorter times, that will also make our process more efficient. And then we can end up with a new process. The preparation time, let's say, would take much less because we have a software support for the preparing of the test template. Isolation and connect would still be the same. We don't have an influence on that. But then test one, for example, because we are doing the three-phase simultaneous injection instead of phase one and then phase two and then phase three, with only a third of the time. And because we don't have the rewiring effort between the separate tests, this is also very much reduced. After that, test four has happened. We would remove the wiring. It would still be the same as before and reconnect. And then the post-processing is also very different than before, because what you need to look at, whereas before we have many different test sets, for each we have a different system. We need to combine the results manually. We need to make a report and so on. We need to do the analysis of it. All of this can happen with a support from the software in an automatic way. So basically, through smart software integration and through the reduction of physical effort, we can reduce, we can have now the much improved or optimized process, so to say. Which leads to, if we look again at our picture, much shorter testing times. Now, there are two benefits that come with this. First, we could have a shorter outage time, or we could also use the time that we have normally spent for additional tests that we would need to do to complement the picture. Either way, just to summarize now, Efficiency can be optimized through one test setup for multiple diagnostic tests, means that I have to connect only one time the wiring, that I do the three-phase synchronous injection of signals versus single phase, and then a good software support that helps with the automatic test execution and the assessment of the results, and afterwards the safeguarding of the data in the system. Yeah, following this logic. Now, I would like to show a few practical examples on how this would look again on our three assets, the power transformers, the instrument transformers, and the circuit breakers. First on the power transformer. So let's assume we arrive, we isolate the transformer, and then we have to do only one connection like here, high voltage side and low voltage side and the tap changer. And this connection is enough for all the tests that we would perform. And what would all the tests be? Transformer turns ratio, magnetizing current, winding resistance, also dynamic resistance over all taps, short circuit impedance, frequency response of stray losses, vector group check, and also the core demagnetization. For the power factor test, we would need to have a separate connection, but all the other tests would happen with this one connection. So we can, with this number of tests, we can get a good overview over all components and in a relatively short testing time. And I want to show this with an example. So let's say that we arrive at the substation, isolating from the grid would take us 60 minutes for a big transformer. And then we would do a measurement of the winding resistance and dynamic resistance over 19 taps, which would take us quite a long time because we have to wait on each of the taps for the current to become stable, to take a winding resistance measurement. And because we are doing a one-phase measurement, we have to do it three times. So that's why this test usually takes a very long time. Then we would need to change the connections for the measurement of the winding resistance on the low voltage winding. And after we would change the connection and do the demagnetization of the core. Especially after the winding resistance measurement, it's important to demagnetize the core because it is quite magnetized and it can then impact other measurements. So, and then we would remove test instrument and reconnect the grid. So this process would take us around 5.5 hours. And you can also relate this to your own process. Maybe you have a similar time than this, depending on the instrument you use, the size of transformer or not. And we are now looking at this. These times can be significantly reduced by using an optimized three-phase approach. The isolating from the grid would still be the same. Takes the same time, there is no impact, but because we are doing a three-phase simultaneous measurement and we have no rewiring between the phases, we have much reduced the measurement time for the winding resistance and dynamic resistance measurement. Then, because we can use the same connection setup for the next measurement, we don't have this step. We completely remove this step. And the measurement on the low voltage winding LV takes only 10 minutes. Why? Because we don't do it phase by phase. We do it in three phases at the same time. And then we also don't have to connect between this and the next measurement. All the tests are done with the same connection. So it's only in the beginning connect and in the end remove. So in this case, we have less than half of the measurement time. If before we want to remove and reconnect to the grid, we want to do additional measurements, like in this case, it would add further time. So in this case, we change the connection to the ratio measurement and exciting current, change the connection to the short circuit impedance measurement, and then change the connections again, measure the power factor on the transformer and then on the bushings. So we would add another 3 hours before we remove the test instrument and reconnect it to the grid. And here again, in comparison with the optimized approach, because we still have the connection from before that we use again, we don't have this. Measurement of ratio would also be only 30% of the one phase and no reconnection at this place, and measurement of short circuit impedance would only be 10 minutes. Now, as I said before, for the power factor measurement, we would still have the same because of the high voltage test and safety reasons needs to be done separately. But nevertheless, we can also say half of the time achieved. So in summary, we have 5.5 plus 2.5, so 5.5 and 8.5 versus 4 hours, so less than half of the time for all the tests. This is the power transformer. So next comes the instrument transformer. And as I said, in the instrument transformer, the accuracy is a very important factor for both metering and protection. And if we look at it in the conventional way, testing in the laboratory, so it's either completely disconnecting the CT, bringing it to the laboratory and having a setup with a very accurate reference CT or VT and measurement devices. So this is something that is normally not done because it is too much effort. And in terms of on-site testing, we have the possibility, and the conventional way to do it is the primary current and voltage injection method. Now, the disadvantage with this method is that it is very requires a very high effort to do it, because we are looking at a lot of heavy equipment and that we need to bring on the truck, and it's if we want to do this measurement according to the standard, it will take a long time because we have to simulate different burden and also different current and voltage values to reach the standard assessment. So that's why in the beginning of presentation we were shown this would take many hours. So advantages are at a high precision. It's a real life test. We are using primary values to test it, and then we have the burden simulation. But there are also a lot of disadvantages here. So based on what I said, the high effort, the heavy equipment, it's also in some extent dangerous and so forth. So rather than the conventional, there is also the possibility to do a model-based testing. Now, model-based, what does it mean? You see here the instrument transformer equivalent circuit. And we use this basically to automate the test procedure and have another approach. So, and I'm going to explain it in a bit, how does it work? And first of all, it's not a classical conventional calibration, but if the conventional test is done at the manufacturer, or even one time on site and then confirmed with the model-based approach for subsequent following maintenance measurement, it is a much more efficient way to do it. And the way that it is done is that we are assuming we know the electrical model of the CT, the equivalent circuit. So with a series of three measurements, we determine the parameters. And by knowing these parameters, we can then for any theoretical primary current calculate the corresponding secondary current at the relevant burden. And this is a matter of minutes. So as I said, we are measuring the winding resistance here, and then the core losses, the eddy losses and the hysteresis losses, and then the ratio, the turns ratio. And this gives us the CT model, which then for any theoretical primary current, we can calculate in no time the secondary current. So these are the three measurements that I mentioned first, and this happens all also with the same connection. So first we measure the secondary winding resistance, then the excitation curve, and the excitation curves gives us the information on the core losses. And then third is a ratio measurement, which then determines the turns ratio. And with that, we can, based on the formula here, we can calculate the error. And this measurement takes somewhere between 1 and 5 minutes per circuit breaker, per current transformer, and up to 20 minutes per voltage transformer. The measurement time is depending on the size of the iron core. The bigger the core, the higher the voltage level, the longer would be the time. But the accuracy of this method is accurate enough to verify metering CTs with class 0.1. So that's what the result would look like. It is absolutely compliant with the relevant standard. And as mentioned, if we would like to do that with the primary injection method, it would take a very long time because of we would have to simulate many different currents and voltages and also burdens. So by this method, in a similar fashion, we can do all tests of the accuracy with one setup. And it is basically also a one button test, an automatic test sequence within the range of minutes. Now, next we are looking at the circuit breaker diagnosis. As mentioned before, we have different components, the control operating mechanism, the mechanical linkage in between, and the interrupter at the top. And for each of those elements, we have different tests available. So we have the static and dynamic contact resistance for the interrupter itself. For the testing of the mechanism, we have the timing and the contact travel. For the charging motor, the motor current analysis, and for the electrical control, the condition of the coil, the coil current profile, under voltage, and minimum pickup tests. So in a traditional sense, also, if you imagine, you would have to do these tests with different test equipment. So you connect one, remove the wiring, connect another. So it would lead to relatively long testing time. And also because in a traditional measurement setup, you use many high voltage, high current cables that are very heavy. So here we would see, for example, the measurement of the timing, and then we would need to remove it and add the measurement for the static contact resistance. And if we would do a minimum pickup test, that is to see at what voltage level would the coil, the trip coil, operate, then we would have to do this manually ramp up the coil voltage. So in an optimized way, again, the same principle applies. We have only one setup, and we use this one setup for all the tests. So important is, for the safety aspect, to ground the circuit breaker on both sides, like shown in this picture here. Then we have one main unit at the bottom that is connected to the contact module. The contact module is up here. It's relatively small, and from the contact module, the current cables are going to each side of the interrupter. And at the bottom, we have another module which is used as an input for the transducer signal for the motion test. And in a similar fashion, with one test setup, we can do all the tests at the push of one button in an automatic test sequence. And the test alone without connection would take somewhere within 15 minutes for all tests for these three circuit breakers. So quite much reduced test time if we compare to do the test with for each of these things with a separate test instrument. Yeah, so these are the methods how we can achieve this increased efficiency in substation testing. But one aspect that I would like to, at the end of my presentation, a quick look at is the impact of the software. Because normally, traditionally, we are looking at hardware, but we are forgetting that software nowadays plays a very big role. And here in the overall test process, we are looking at four factors that are connected to each other. First, it starts with the asset data, because this provides the reference of what we are testing. Then we are looking at the testing itself. This means the test plan. How is the test plan made? How is the test plan executed? Is it executed automatically or manually? Do we have to think a lot? Do we have to do many settings? And then also, how about the results that we get? Are they assessed immediately? Do I get immediate feedback? And so on. And this brings us to the analyzing of the results. How can we compare them to the previous results that we have done last time when we tested them? Do we have the possibility to set our limits, and so on? And afterwards, also a very important part is the management of the data, all the things we get out from our testing process. How do we handle it? And especially as a utility gets bigger, it becomes important to do that, so that all the relevant team members have access to the information that is needed for their testing. So for each of these four aspects, we have many sub aspects that are important. And here I just outline a little bit the process that is related to this. So first, it's important that we have the asset definition, that this happens easily, that we can enter the nameplate information, where it is located, which substation, what are the assessment limits, everything that is important for this certain asset under test. Then the automated test plan preparation, so that basically we do only say we want to do this test and this test and this test, and based on our selection, the complete test plan is already generated, and it saves us a lot of time. And then we come to the execution of the test plan in the substation. Here, a lot of help can be given during the connection already by the wiring diagrams. But one thing that I want to highlight here is also the automated execution. Let's say we have one connection for all tests, then we have one big benefit. We can say start the test one time and all the tests can be run through automatically from beginning to end. And this is really something that can save a lot of time and make the process very efficient. And after that, when we have the results, how easy it is to assess them, do we get instant feedback and failed or pass criteria and so on. And then the report, do we have to write the report? Do we have to copy or do we have to just say print report because it's already automatically prepared? And then how easy it is to further process this data in the company. How easy is it for the relevant people to access it and to see it? So many aspects when we look at it, and as much as it is important to have a optimized hardware, the software plays an equally important part. Yeah, here basically in a similar way, one more time, the test procedure, use defined asset information, prepare tests all the way through to have it safely stored in the database. So I'm arriving at the end of my presentation, and here just a quick overview one more time, comparing conventional testing with many test devices and a lot of connection effort and a lot of manual and also mental effort where we have to do and where we also can make maybe easily more mistakes versus an optimized approach where we say we try to use a equipment that we connect once and that can do all the tests ideally in an automatic sequence as to be able to save as much time as possible. Also, because in the beginning I mentioned safety, so I would like to say that we believe that the optimized approach is also much safer than the conventional approach because we only have to go on top of the asset one time to do the connection, not many times. And just from that aspect alone, it increases the operator safety, besides all the additional safety features that are part of it. And yeah, so just also to outline what new possibilities this brings with it, because looking at this, this is something new. It wasn't there before. So now that we have it, what can we do with it? So it could be that one team would do the testing on the transformer, as it's here indicated, and another team in parallel could do the testing on the instrument transformers. And because it goes quite much faster, could then move on to the circuit breaker. So these two teams could finish testing on all assets of this feeder within the same time, more or less. And as compared to before, the outage that was necessary for just the transformer would be able to save 50% of the time, which can be used for additional testing or which can be used to put the system back in operation. Yep. So that is the end of my presentation. I'm almost on time. And yeah, so if there are some questions now, I'm happy to answer them. Not just that, you can also send me your questions whenever you want. I'm leaving my email address here at the bottom, and you are free to send me an email whenever you want. I would be happy to get back to you.
Okay, thank you very much, Christian, for your very nice presentations. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. If there are any questions from the participant, you can ask the question or type your question in the chat so we can see your questions. If not, maybe I would ask some question. The first one is that when we get the result from the device and then we the software program will evaluate the condition of the equipment for us, like the comparison with the limit for some date, some test result, and show that it's pass or fail or not.
Yes, that is correct. And for this purpose, you have different possibilities. You can either choose standard defined limits that are given by IEC standard or IEEE standard, or if you have your own limits, you can set also custom limits if your company or your utility decide to have a different limit, more conservative or less conservative than standard level.
Okay, Christian, you see the first question in the chat?
Yep. So it says there, what are the new test tools available in the market? Because in this presentation, I did not want to focus so much on the product and on the name of the product, but more about the principle that we apply. I have not mentioned it, but since it has been asked for the transformer testing, it would be the, I can write it also. Sorry, everyone, yes. So for the transformer testing, we call our product Testrano, that what you have seen there. For the circuit breaker testing, we call it Sibano. And for CT, CT analyzer and Votano for instrument transformer testing. And in a way, they are like a family. They all have the same characteristics in terms of how they work. All of them are one connection to the test object, and all of them have the automatic test with the one button test execution. I think if anyone is interested in more information about this, as I said, you can email me here at this email address, but I think you can equally contact our partner, Unipower Engineering in Thailand. They would be happy. I think they have also all this equipment with them, so they would be able to show it to you in person.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think there is no more question, right, Christian?
Yep. As I said, if you have some questions afterwards, anytime, I'm always happy to receive your email.
Okay. Then if there is no further question, or there is one asking for the question. Yes?
Yep.
Tan Kom San, please. I saw Ajahn Kom San would like to ask a question, but he can unmute his microphone. Yeah? Could you please open microphone for him?
Yes, Christian.
Hello.
Hello. I have three questions.
Yes, please.
First one, your equipment can replace the acceptance test or not? Acceptance test on site. Because I believe that they do not use full test voltage and full test current.
That is also what I said in my presentation. There is, in some utilities, the acceptance test is done in the factory, but it is correct what you say, the As we say, the model-based approach is not same with the primary injection approach. But once the acceptance test has been done, and here we are also suggesting the regular maintenance test, and what we are suggesting more is, let's say, the feeder is offline because someone is doing a transformer test. So why not use the possibility, since the equipment is available offline and very fast, do a verification with the model-based approach.
Thank you. The second one is, in your opinion, nowadays we have 61850. It's condition-based. What is your opinion comparing to your preventive maintenance and condition-based maintenance?
So what you're referring to is online monitoring. Do I understand correctly? Because IEC 61850 is more a protection and control center technology. So what we are focusing here is still the testing of the physical parameters of the high voltage asset in the field.
Yes, but your equipment also show some parameter that affect the operation. Mm-hmm. Because your equipment cannot guarantee the accuracy. If the equipment can guarantee the accuracy of CCVC, the equipment should have more or less 35 by 17 to 50, for example.
So I can only say that many of the institutions like KIMA and so on have already certified our instrument transformer test set to be suitable to test and verify the accuracy and calibrate the accuracy of metering CT and VT with a class 0.1.
Yes, yes, understand. So you mean that for CT VT, it's only detect some change. If it's some change, we still need to verify again.
So I think I understand what is your question. So if you change the burden, if you change the relay of the CTVT or the energy meter of the CTVT, of course the overall accuracy is impacted as compared to before. Now, what is possible in our software, you don't have to do the measurement again. You only have to measure burden of new instrument, and then the accuracy verification is recalculated based on the new burden.
Okay, thank you. That's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So in the chat, one guy would like to ask you to send a presentation for him because he cannot listen continuously.
Yeah, I think that the presentation file can be requested from our friends at Unipower Engineering.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That should not be a problem if someone is interested.
Yeah. Any more questions? I think there's no more question, right? Then it's time to, it's also the time now. We have half past three already. Okay, on behalf of IEEE PES Thailand, I would like to say thank you very much to Mr. Christian Eng for your time and effort for sharing your knowledge and experience with us in this webinar. And also thank you IEEE PES Thailand and organizer for organizing this webinar series for today, and also the participant for your time and listening to this interesting topic. I hope to see again next time. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you also. Pleasure, very big pleasure for me to be here and to be here. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you everyone. Goodbye.
Goodbye.